Thank you. the church will dismiss him, have no more fellowship with him. And Jesus said, whatever you loose on earth, I'll loose in heaven. That's the reason you have so much troubles, because you don't follow the Bible principles.
Amen.
If somebody in the church is causing a disturbance or something going wrong, it's not your duty to go talk about that man or that woman. It's your duty to go to that man or woman and tell him his error. And if he won't hear you, take some other one with you. If he won't hear that, then the church loses him. Jesus said, what you loose on earth, I'll loose in heaven. What you bind on earth, I'll bind in heaven. That's the power of the church. You're not long ago a good preacher friend of mine. He had a boy. And that boy had been going to church, his own church. He got to a place where he started running around with a little old girl who smoked and drank and carried on. Preacher said, of course, that's his business. A very bosom friend of mine and a nice boy. But he got all infatuated with some young woman. And she'd been married, had some children. Her husband is living. He's afraid he's going to have that boy would marry her. So their brother was all tore up. And he said to me, Brother Branham, I want you to go to this certain boy of mine. I want you to talk to him. I said, Brother, I almost called his name. You have a better way. Don't send me. If the boy's not living up and the church has saw him doing wrong, then it's a thing for the church to do this business. That's left with the church. And the church goes over and tells him. So he took a brother and went over and told him. And he got back at the brother, letting him know he was tending to his own business, for him to do the same. He took another brother, two deacons, went over and told the boy. He wouldn't listen to it. They told it to the church. And he never come for several nights to be reconciled to the church after his sin was told before the church. Then the church loosed him. And about a month from then, he was stricken down with pneumonia. And the doctor said, there's not a chance in the world for him to live. Then he crawled back. God knows how to do it. We try to do it in ourselves. Oh, you're kicked so-and-so out of church. You're do this, that, and the other. Have you done your part as a church towards it? There you are. That's the way to make them crawl back. Turn them over to the devil one time. What Paul said about this man down there was living with his stepmother. They couldn't get him reconciled. Said, turn him over to the devil. Watch what happens. And in the next letter Paul wrote, this man had got straightened out. Sure, God has a way of doing these things if we'll just follow his rules. If something goes wrong in the church, if it's amongst the congregation, each one of you brothers, put on the deacon board. One of you deacons, don't behave. The other deacons, come and have a meeting. Try to reconcile a brother. Tell him what he's doing, or one of you members, whatever you are. Then it's to be brought before him. If you won't do it, then come tell the pastor. Then he's loose from the church, and then let him be as a heathen and a publican. Then watch the Lord go to work on him. See? That's when he comes back to himself. That's when he goes to crawling in. But we try to do it ourselves, you know, try to do everything the way we should do it. Now, we never make a success. Now, this Melchizedek, the king of Salem, priest of the Most High, met Abraham and blessed him and gave him this tithings. Abraham did, and he was the king of Salem, and he brought out bread and wine, the communion, and gave it to Abraham after the battle, after the man had been won over. Now, all wars, as I say, are fought for principles. Now, if you have a little war in church, it must be the right principle. You must be fighting for the right thing. And each member of the church is supposed to do that. Now, this teaching is for the church. That's what we're here for. That's what I'm standing here for. That's what God's Word's for. It's for the church. Don't never let nothing hinder this church. If it does, you're guilty. Each one of you. And you and your different churches, if something's going wrong in your church, you're guilty because you're the overseer of that church. It ain't up to the pastor. It ain't up to the deacon board. It's up to you, you individual, to go to that brother and see if you can have him reconciled. If not, then take two or three with you. Then come back. If you won't hear that, tell it to the church. Then he's dismissed from the kingdom of God. God said, if you dismiss him there, I'll dismiss him here. If you went through this order, then he'll turn the devil loose to him for the destruction of his flesh, and then he'll come back. That's right. That's the way to make him come back. If he's a child of God, he will come back. If he isn't, well, he'll go on. And then the devil will send him on to his eternal place. Now, the motives of it. If you just get it in for somebody, then that's different. But if the man is guilty, and Lot had went down and had backslid, though he was a Hebrew, he went down and was backslid. He was in grace, but he had fallen from it. And when he went out, and Lot was saved, don't never think that Lot wasn't saved, he was. Because all the time when he was in the wrong place, the Bible said that the sins of Sodom vexed his righteous soul daily.
Amen.
Now his flesh was doing one thing, and what was his end? He brought more disgrace, his wife turned to a pillar of salt, he had children by his daughters. So you can see what a disgrace it brought, because he had fallen from grace and never restored himself back again, and God had to take him out of the earth. But still he was a fallen brother, and Abraham done all that he could do to bring him back again. And the spirit was in Abraham is the spirit of Christ that's in the church today. No matter what the brother's done, you'll do all you can to bring him back into the fellowship of Christ again. No matter what he's done, you'll try hard. Now, we want to notice here now again, as we go on with this lesson of this Melchizedek, this great priest of Salem and the possessor of heavens and earth, now being first without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor ending of life, but was made like unto the Son of God, abideth the priest continually. Now watch. He wasn't the Son of God. He was the God of the Son. He wasn't the Son of God, Melchizedek wasn't, but he was the Father of the Son of God. Now this body that he had, he had created. It had not been brought to a woman. So with that created body, he could not, somebody had made himself to reveal himself. No man can see God at any time. God is a spirit. Mortal eyes doesn't see those things. Unless it's in the form like the pillar of fire or whatever it was, or in the form of some being that they seen by vision. But the God has to reveal himself through some way. And God revealed himself to Abraham in the form of a man. He revealed himself to Moses in the form of a man. He revealed himself to the children of Israel in the form of a pillar of fire. He revealed himself unto John the Baptist in the form of a dove. You see, he revealed himself in those forms. When he was revealing himself in the form of a man as a king of Salem, of Jerusalem, not of the earthly Jerusalem, but the heavenly Jerusalem. He revealed himself in that form. He was made like unto the Son of God. Now the Son of God had to come through a woman to be created here by the womb of a woman, because through that same thing come death. And he could not come through creation like God did at the beginning. When God made man at the beginning, woman had nothing to do with it. God just said, let there be. And a man came from the dust. He called him without any woman to have anything to do with it. But the woman then was in the man. And God took the woman out of Adam's side. Is that right? And then woman went and brought man through sex. So the only way that God could do, he couldn't come in that theosomy, he couldn't come as Melchizedek. He had to come as a man, and he had to come through the woman. Thy seed shall bruise the serpent's head, and his head will bruise your heel. Get it? God had to come to a woman. And he did when he dwelt in his body of his Son, Christ Jesus. God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. And he offered his own blood as a sacrifice and gave his life, that through that channel of death he might save you into eternal life. So God came then, and he was made like unto the Son of God.
Amen.
See, he was a man made like the Son of God. Now he couldn't be the Son of God, because this man is eternal. The Son of God had a beginning, he had an end. He had a time of his birth, he had a time of his death. He had both beginning and end. He had both father and mother. This man had neither father nor mother, beginning or end of time. But he was made, this man, Melchizedek, was made like the Son of God. Now the Son of God, when he was come into the world in the form of a woman, or flew a woman in man's form, and was killed, raised up again on the third day, rose for our justification. Now he abides forever. And as long as that body abides, we abide too. And because he raised up from the dirt, we'll be raised up in his likeness.
Amen.
There is a gospel story. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Not angels, not supernatural beings, not a bunch of feathers to flop around, but men and women.
Amen.
Amen. And in his likeness.
Praise
yes, sir. I've often told this, I say it again, this time it seems suitable. I was combing about this 5 or 6 hairs that I have left, and my wife said, "Billy, you're getting bald-headed." I said, "But I haven't lost one of them." She said, "Where are they at?" I said, "Tell me where they was before I got them. I'll tell you where they are waiting for me." That's right. I used to be a fighter, pugilist. I was strong and big. And I felt if you set this church on my back and walk down the street with it. I tell you, when I get up in the morning now, I realize it's 40-something years has passed. See, I'm not what I used to be. I'm failing every day. As I look at my hands and think, "Look here. Well, I'm getting an old man." I look at my shoulders. I see I've gained a lot of weight. I used to wear a 28 on a belt. I wear a 30 now. See, I'm getting old, fat, dwindling away. What is it? I eat the same thing I used to eat. I live cleaner and better than I used to live. The same thing, but God has appointed a time for me, and I must receive it.
Amen.
But the blessed thought is that at that day he'll raise me up again.
Amen.
And everything that I was when I was 25 years old, I'll be again forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
There you are.
Hallelujah.
What does old age bother me?
Amen.
I beat the devil out of that for years and years.
Amen.
Knowing this, that I believe him.
Amen.
This little span's a little short thing anyhow. If we only stay 70 years old, our promised time. What's that but misery and sorrow? What is it? Would you swap this pest house for that glorious thing yonder? Well, blessed be the name of the Lord. Something on the inside of me met that Melchizedek one day.
Amen.
And he spoke peace to me and he gave me eternal life. And this life means nothing but a tabernacle to preach the gospel through.
Amen.
I say this with all sincerity, these two Bibles ain't open before me. If my God was through with me preaching the gospel and I could do no more for him, my children was old enough to take care of themselves. If he wants to take me right now, amen.
Amen.
That settles it. Yes, sir. What difference does it make if I'm 80 or if I'm 20? I'm only here for one thing, to serve the Lord.
Amen.
That's all. If I can still preach the gospel like I do now when I'm 80, what difference does it make whether I'm 40 or 80?
Amen.
There's a many men 80 years old tonight, there's a lot of children will die. Well, that 80-year-old man will outlive them, any one of them. What difference does it make? It's your motives, your principles. And we're here to serve the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
That's all, knowing this, that this life is a vapor that a man speaks about that once was and then is not. But if we have eternal life, God's promised he'll raise us up again and we'll take the communion with him when the days are over and we say, enter into the joys of the Lord that's been prepared for you
Amen.
Since the foundation of the world.
Thank God.
Then what difference does it make here whether we have anything or whether we don't?
Amen.
Whether we're young or whether we're old.
Amen.
What difference does it make?
Blessed be God.
The main thing, are you ready to meet
Amen.
Him?
Amen.
Do you love him? Can you serve him?
Amen.
Have you sold out to the things of the world?
Amen.
Have you met Melchizedek?
Amen.
Since the battle was over.
Bless
God, about 21
Amen.
Years old I was, and one day I had a battle with this, that,
Amen.
And the other. I couldn't make out whether I want to be a fighter, whether I want to be a trapper or a hunter, what I want to be, but I met Melchizedek.
Amen.
And he gave me communion, and since then it was
Amen.
Settled forever.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. I went on his side. I've been rejoicing on the road, and when it comes to the end of the road and death stares me in the face, the way I feel now, I'll never dread it. I won't want to walk into the face of it knowing this, that I know him who's made the promise.
Amen.
That's right, that I know him in the power of his resurrection. When he calls from among the dead, I'll come out from among them.
Amen.
That's right, knowing him in the power of his resurrection. What difference does it make whether I'm old or whether I'm young, whether I'm little or whether I'm big,
Amen.
Whether I'm full or whether I'm hungry, whether I got a place laid out or whether I haven't. The birds has The nest of the fox has dens, but the Son of Man has not a place to lay his head. But he was the King of glory.
Amen. Thank God.
We're kings and priests tonight. What difference does it make whether we have or whether we haven't?
Amen.
As long as we got God, we are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors.
Hallelujah.
We sit in the presence of God, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
Taking spiritual communion from the hands of Him that testified. I was He that was dead and alive again, and I'm alive forevermore.
Amen.
Setting you together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Oh, blessed be His holy name. What difference does it make? A tenor cottage, why should I care?
Amen.
They're building a palace for me over there. Of rubies and diamonds and
Amen.
Silver and gold. His coffers are full. He has riches untold. I met him one day when I come from the battle. I laid my trophies down. I ain't fought a battle since then.
Amen.
He fights them for me.
Hallelujah.
I just rest upon his promise, knowing this, that I know him in the power of his resurrection. That's all that matters. What else does matter? What can we do? Why taking thought can add one cubic to your statue? What do you care whether your hair is curly or whether you got any or not? What difference does it make? If you're old, if you're gray, if you're stoop-shouldered, if you're not, what difference does it make?
Amen.
Amen. This is just for a spell, a little space, but that's forever and forever. And as aeons of time roll on, as the ages roll on, you'll never change in this through his ceaseless eternal ages. What difference does it make? I'm so glad I met him. I'm so glad he gave me communion one day. That same Melchizedek that met Abraham coming from the slaughter of the kings. Certainly. The God of heaven, the Elohim, the great I am, not the I was, I am. Present tense. And he blessed him. Listen here just a little further so we can get the lesson a little closer together.
Amen.
Now the fourth verse. Now consider how great this man was. I just think that too. Consider how great this man was. He's beyond the Son of God. The Son of God had father and mother. He didn't. The Son of God had a beginning of time and an ending of time. He didn't. Who was that? That was the Father of the Son.
Amen.
That's who it was. Consider how great this man was. Unto even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of all the spoils. Now listen closely. And verily they that are of the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, have commandment to take tithings of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they came out of the loins of Abraham. Watch this if you want to see something. But he whose descent is not contended, for from then receiveth tithes of Abraham, and blessed him that had the promise. Abraham had the promise, and this man blessed Abraham who had the promise. Who was this? The sons of Levi paid tithes to their brethren, or their brethren paid tithes to them. They had a commandment of the Lord to take a tenth of what their brothers made for their living, because they were the priesthood. Now that lets out the Melchizedek priesthood, as you talk about right there.
Amen.
That's right. But this man, even the one who had the promise, the greatest man on earth, Abraham,
Amen.
Met this man and paid tithes to him. He had to be greater.
Amen.
Listen. And without any contradiction, the less is blessed of the better, certainly.
Amen.
Watch who he is. And here, man that die receive tithes. That's the priesthood of the order of priests and preachers and so forth. Man that receive tithe die. See? But here, he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth. What would a man take tithings for if he never was born and never will die and was from beginning to end and never had no father or mother or descent and owned the whole heavens and earth and all with it? Why would he take tithes? Why would he ask Abraham to pay tithes? You see what a strict thing it is to pay tithes? Tithing's right. Every Christian's duty bound to pay tithes. It's right. Never has been changed. Now, and as I may so say, Levi also who received tithe paid tithes in Abraham. Now, here's something. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. What? Levi, Abraham, was Levi's great-great-grandpa. And the Bible said here that Levi paid tithes when he was in the loins of Abraham. Four generations before he ever come to earth, he was paying tithes to Melchizedek. Blessed be in the name of the Lord. Then you that can't believe in predestination, before ordination. And you're four generations before Levi would ever come out of the loins of Abraham was paying tithes to Melchizedek. Wish we had time to run this through the scripture. If you take it over to like a Jeremiah 1:4, God said, I knew you before you was even formed in your mother's womb. And I sanctified you and ordained you a prophet to the nations. Amen. Then what can you say that you did? What can I say that I did? It's God that showeth mercy. God knew us before the foundation of the world. He's not willing that any should perish, certainly not. But if he's God, he knew who would be saved and who wouldn't be saved, or he didn't know anything.
Amen.
If he didn't know who would make the rapture before the world was ever formed, then he's not God.
Amen.
If he's infant, he knows every flea, every fly, every louse, every chigger.
Amen.
That would ever be on the earth before the earth was ever formed.
Amen.
That's right. He knew all things. Before the foundation of the world, he knew us. The Bible said that he knew us and predestinated us.
Amen.
Let's settle this just once. Let's go back to Ephesians, the first chapter, the fifth chapter, the first chapter of Ephesians, just a moment. I want to read here just a minute. So that you can really understand that it's not just something I'm trying to tell you, it's something God's trying to tell you. See? Now listen to this real close. First chapter of Ephesians. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, the same man wrote the Hebrew letter, is writing this letter. To the saints, this is not to the unbelievers, but to the saints, the sainted ones, which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, according as he, now listen close now, the fourth verse, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Who's the us there? The church.
Amen.
He chose us in him, Christ, before the foundation of the earth, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself according to his own good pleasure of his will. Who did it? God did it.
Amen.
God knowed from the beginning who would be saved and who wouldn't be saved.
Amen.
Certainly he was not willing for any to perish. But he didn't send Jesus here just to see if you'd act like, well, poor Jesus, I feel sorry for him. Maybe I better get saved and approve it. No, sir. God knowed in the beginning who would and who would not. So therefore he knew that some would, so he sent Jesus to make a propitiation for those that he foreknew. For those who he foreknew, he has called. And those who he has called, he has justified. And those who he has justified, he hath, past tense, glorified.
Amen.
There you are. So it's not you that keeps yourself, it's the grace of God that keeps you.
Amen.
You didn't save yourself for nothing you'd done to deserve being saved. It's God's grace that saved you. God's grace called you. God's foreknowledge knew you. He knew that you'd be in this church this night before the foundation of the world was ever laid. If he's infant, if he isn't, he isn't God. If he did know all things, he was God. If he didn't know all things, he wasn't God.
Amen.
If he's Almighty God, he can do all things. If he cannot do all things, he's not Almighty God.
Amen.
There you are. So how can you say it's something you could do? It's nothing you can do. It's God's loving grace to you that you're even here.
Yeah.
Nothing you could do. God calls you by his grace. You listen and heard, accepted. Well, you say, Brother Branham, that makes it awful loose. Certainly does. You're free. Well, that fellow can do anything he wants to. Absolutely. I always do what I want to do. But if you're a Christian, you don't want to do wrong. There's a little old girl sitting back there tonight, my wife. I love her with all that's in me. And if I know that I could run around with another woman and get by with it and go tell her and say, Media, I did wrong. Do you think I'd do it? If I love her right, I won't do it. That's right. Now, what if I say, oh, I can't do it because I tell you why. She divorced me and I got, oh, I'm a preacher. See, what did I do? That take me out of the pulpit and she divorced me and all. I got three children. I couldn't think of that. But boy, if that's the way it is, you're still legal. It's not legal basis that I married her up on. It's not legal basis that makes me live true to her. It's because I love her.
That's right.
Yeah. I don't have to do anything. I do it willfully because it's a love affair.
Emma.
And if you love your wife, you'll do the same thing.
Yeah.
And if you love your wife like that, with filial love, what aren't you to do to Christ with agapo love? Which is a million times stronger.
Amen.
If you really love God, if I know tonight I could go out and get on a drunk. If I know tonight I could run around and be immoral. If I know tonight that's even in my heart to do so. And I went and let it go and he'd forgive me. I wouldn't do it.
Amen.
I think too much of him.
Amen.
I love him.
Yeah.
Sure. Certainly. That's the reason I wouldn't sell my experience to any denomination.
Amen.
No, sir. No Assemblies of God, no Church of God, no Pilgrim Holiness, Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, Catholic. I wouldn't take anything that could be offered for this experience because it never come by man, it come by God. No, sir. I wouldn't sell my birthrights for any Elvis Presley's rock and roll or for his fleet of Catholics or his Cadillacs or his $1 million and so forth he gets each month. No, sir. I love him.
Amen.
And if I, as long as I love him like that, I'll stay true to him.
Amen.
And if God's called me and elected me, he's placed something in me. And I love him.
Amen.
I remember Mr. Eisler. You all know him, most all of you. He's come right here, state senator of Indiana, come here play his guitar. And my baby had died and wife had died and all of them laying up here in the graveyard. And I was going up the road with my hands behind me crying. He jumped out of his little old truck and come put his arm around me. He said, Billy, I want to ask you a question. Said, I've heard you preach to you, almost fall in the pulpit. Heard you on the street corners and everything, crying out for Christ. Said, now he took your daddy, he took your brother, snatched them both and they died in your arms. There he died, your wife died holding your hands, and your baby died, and you calling on him to help you. And he turned his back on you. What do you think about him? I said, I love him with all that's within me.
Amen.
If he sends me to hell, I'll still love him. Just, I don't say that. 26 years has proved it. That's right. If you love him, not a duty that I can't do this and I can't do that, you love him too much to do it.
Amen.
Because he has chosen you. You never chose him. He chose you.
Yeah.
You said, I sought the Lord and sought the Lord. No man seeks God. It's God seeking man.
Amen.
You might be seeking a favor of him, but God has to change your nature before you can even seek after him. Because you're a sinner. You're a pig. That's right. Some of you people going to church and just living by your membership. Go out here and do everything of the world and then still go back and say, yeah, I belong to the church. Well, that's a long ways from belonging to God.
Amen.
Certainly. I don't, but you see people doing that, you can tell, oh, they're good church members. That's true. You can still be a church member and do those things. But you can't be a Christian in doing them.
Amen.
As I said this morning, the old crow. If there ever was a hypocrite, it's the crow. That's right. Him and the dove sat on the same ark, sat in the same roost. And the old crow was satisfied when he was turned loose and got out of that church that he could go out there and sit on one old dead carcass and caw, caw, and eat off of this one, eat off the horse, eat off the cow, and whatever it was, he was satisfied. But when Noah turned the dove loose, she could find no rest for the soles of her feet. She had just as much right to sit on a dead animal as a crow did. But it was two different natures. One of them, she was a dove to begin with. He was a crow to begin with. But if you notice, the old crow can sit over here on a dead carcass and eat half the day. The dove will sit in a wheat field and eat half the day. And the crow can fly right out there and eat dove food as much as he wants to. He can eat just as much wheat as the crow can, or as the dove can. But the crow can eat the dove food, but the dove can't eat crow food.
Amen.
That's right. So an old hypocrite can come to church and rejoice and shout and praise the Lord and go on like that and go right back out and enjoy the things of the world. But a born-again Christian cannot do it because the love of God constrains him to such a place. He can't do it. So if you're just a Christian by joining the church and quitting doing this and that and the same desires in you need another dip.
Amen.
That's exactly right. And you women who can dress with them little old shorts and ride here on the street and then call yourself a believer. You're a believer, but you're a poor example of one, maybe. If you really had Christ in your heart, you wouldn't have to think about such things as that. I don't care what the rest of women does and the rest of girls do. You'd be different because you love Christ too much. I talked to a woman the other day in the house, and she threw her hands up like this. She said, Reverend Branham, I'm almost naked here in my house. I'm walking around. I thought, shame on you. In your own house, don't care where you are. That's right. Dress and act like a woman, like a lady ought to. Shame on you. But you keep, the Bible said, if you love those things, the things of the world, the love of Christ is not even in you. If you love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, you'll keep them little dirty, nasty things off of you. That's right. And you deacon and you others here that run out on the street, you're gawking your neck and looking at every one of them women. Shame on you and calling yourselves sons of God. I know that's scorching, but rather be scorched than burnt forever. So if you do those things, now you can't help it. If a woman walks down the street half-dressed, if you're looking, you're bound to see her, but you can turn your head. The Bible says, whosoever looketh upon a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in heart. Let me tell you something, sister dear. You're going to answer, I don't care, you might be as pure as a lily. You may never actually committed a sin of that type, immoral sin in your life. But if you dress like that, you're going to answer the judgment for committing adultery with every man that looked at you.
Amen.
The Bible said.
Amen.
Walk down the street. Who's guilty, the man? No, sir, you are. You presented yourself that way. The woman's got a great place. It's a sacred, nice, wonderful place. But she must keep herself that way to hold her office as she should as a mother, as a woman. And a womanhood, when the womanhood's broke, a backbone of any nation's broke. That's the reason our nation is ruinous, because of the immorals of our women.
That's
exactly right. Sure. It's the rottenness among us what's breaking it. What you need is to meet this Melchizedek one time.
Amen.
Amen. Let him bless you and give you the wine and the bread, eternal life. Then you'll see things different. Then it'll be different. You won't want the boys to be making a coyote whistle at you, the wolf whistle, or whatever you want to call it. Certainly not. You'll be different. And you mean to tell me that you dress like that and get out there for any other purpose? You say, well, it's cooler. You're storytelling. It is not cooler. Science proves that it's not cooler. It's a lust that's come up on you, sister. You don't realize it. I'm not trying to hurt you, but I'm trying to warn you. A many a moral woman, just as clean as she can be, a nice little lady, walk out with them things on the street, unconscious of knowing what she's doing. Because some backslidden preacher is afraid your husband won't pay his tithes in the church anymore. If he'd ever met Melchizedek, he wouldn't think those things. He'd preach the gospel if it sparks the hide off their back. He'd preach it anyhow. That's exactly right. You do it, and you do it because of the spirit of lust that's up. And you, man, that'll let your wives do those kind of things, I've got little hopes of you as a man. That's right. That's right. Now, there's no compliments on that, because there's no apology, because that's true. Any man that'll let his wife get out on the street and act like that, brother, you are to be wearing her clothes. That's right. I don't say my wife won't do it. But I have to be changed and perverted to what I am now if I ever live with her while she's doing it. And that's exactly right. My girls, they may do it. When they get to be women, I don't say they won't. I don't know. That's at the mercy of God. I hope they don't. If they do, they'll walk over the prayers of a righteous father.
Amen.
They'll walk over the life of somebody who tries to live right if they ever do it. That's right. Oh, I want to live right, teach right, be right, and instruct them right. If they do that, they'll beat their way to hell over the top of my preaching, over the top of my Christ, and over the top of my warnings. That's right, if they ever do it. Certainly, that's right. Shame on you. If you ever meet Christ face to face and he blesses you and puts that kiss of approval on your heart, all devils in hell will never make you put them on again. That's right. You've changed from death into life, and your affections are set on things above and not on the things of the earth. Amen. I better leave that subject. It's ticklish. All right. But it's the truth. All right, as we go on now, just a little further, and then we're closing. Verily, they that are of the sons of Levi receive tithe of the office of the priesthood, and have a commandment to take tithe of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they came out of the loins of Abraham. But he whose descent is not counted from them that received tithes of Abraham, and blessed of him that had the promise. And with all contradictions, the less is blessed of the better. And here man that die receive tithes, but here he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth. And as I may say, Levi also received tithes, paid tithes in Abraham, for he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. Your attitude towards Christ will make a great impression on what your children will be. Your life that you live before your family will make an impression on what your children will be. Because the Bible said that he'd visit the iniquity of the parents upon the children to the third and fourth generations. Now, just a few moments before closing. And therefore, if perfection, there's your perfection again, were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what farther need that there come another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron, the law, the legalist. See? Oh, you have to do this. If you don't do this, you're not a Christian. If you don't keep the Sabbath, if you eat meat, if you do these things, all these legal ideas, and you've got to go to church. If you don't, you pay a penalty for it. You have to do an obedience. That stuff is nonsense. You're saved by the grace of God, by the foreknowledge of God, by his predestination. God called Abraham by predestination, by foreknowledge. He hated Esau and loved Jacob before either one was born. That's right. It's God's foreknowledge that knows these things. You say, then what's the use of preaching the gospel? Now, I'll say to you this. Paul answered that. Or Jesus did, rather. Here's Jesus. He said, the kingdom of heaven is likened to a man that went to this pond or lake and threw it in a net. He pulled in. Out of there, he had turtles. He had terrapins. He had serpents. He had lizards. He had frogs. He had spiders. He had scavengers. He had fish. Now, the man's just saying him. That's like the gospel. Here it is now. I'm preaching the gospel. I just throw the net out. I pull it. I say, all that will, whosoever, let him come. Here comes some at the altar. They all hang around the altar. They pray. They cry. I don't know one from the other. It's not my business. I wasn't sent to judge. But there's some in there that's frogs. There's some that's lizards. There's some that's snakes. It's some that's turtles. And there's some that's fish. It's not my business to judge. I say, Father, here's what I pulled out. But the frog was a frog to begin with. The spider, the old spider will sit there and look around a little while, wall and big eyes, look around and say, you know what? I just about got as much of this as I can stand. Plop, 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 out they go. Old lady serpent will raise her head up and say, well, you know what? If they go to preach like that against wearing shorts and things, that takes me, so I'll get away with that bunch of holy rollers. That's all it was to be. You was a snake to start with. That's exactly right. Yeah. And here sits old Mr. Toad Frog with that great big cigar in his mouth like a dehorned Texas steer. I'll stand there and look around and say, well, and everything can give me this one. I'll just get out of this thing right now. Well, you old frog, you was that to begin with. That's exactly right. Exactly right. Your nature proves what you are. Your life shows, reflects what you are. And in the beginning, it's not hard for me to see that. It's not hard for you to see it. If I went out to Roy Slaughter's, the farmer sitting here, and I saw the pigs out on manure pile eating manure, I wouldn't think nothing bad about that. He's a pig. But if I saw a lamb up on that manure pile, I'd wonder. See? Don't worry, you won't see him there. He just couldn't stand it. That's right. And a man that's born of the Spirit of God hates the things of the world. That's right. For if you love the world or the things of the world, the love of God's not even in you.
Amen.
If I run around with women every day and come and tell my wife I love her, she'd know I was a liar. My actions would speak louder than my words. Certainly. I proved to her I didn't love her because it wasn't true to her. She told me she loved me, and every time I'd be gone, she'd take over somebody else. It would prove that she didn't love me. Right, her actions proved. I don't care how much she'd try to tell me, Bill, I love you, and there's no one else in the world but you. I know she's a liar. And when you try to say, Lord, I love you, and doing the things of the world, God knows you're a liar to begin with. So what's the use of accepting old halfway experience and something like that when the great skies of heaven are full of the real thing? Why do you want to be a miserable, professed, halfway, half-baked, so-called Christian when you can be a real born-again child of God with the joy bells of heaven ringing in your heart, rejoicing and praising God and living a life of victory through Jesus Christ? Not trying to do it yourself because you have failed to begin with, but take Him at His word and rest upon what He said was the truth. And believe Him and love Him, and He'll make everything work right and right for you. That's it. That's the idea. The Lord bless you. Don't want to scold you. But, brother, it's best to get a little scolding. You're my young'uns, see? And any papa that loves his kids will certainly correct him, or he's not the right kind of a papa. Is that right? That's right. And this papa only has one rule, and that's the rule of the home. And God only has one rule, and that's His Word. If we believe His Word, then we live by His Word. It's our duty, if we've ever met God, not because you say, well, I go to church and I've got to do this. You're miserable. Don't do that. Why do you want to be a miserable, decrepit, ungodly crow for when you can be a dove? Certainly. You just have to have your nature changed. And you change your nature and become a son and daughter of God. Be at peace with God.
Amen.
Jesus, wherefore Jesus also, that He might sanctify the people with His own blood, suffer without the gates. Hebrews 13:12-13. Amen. Romans 5:1, therefore being justified by faith, not by shaking hands, not by water baptism, not by laying out of hands, not with shouting, not with speaking in tongues, not with any sensation, but being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We pass from death unto life and become new creatures, because we have believed on the only begotten Son of God and accepted Him as our personal Savior. And His blood acts tonight as a propitiation for our sins to stand in the place. In the Old Testament, there's only one place to have fellowship. That's under the blood. Every believer had to come under the blood. When the red heifer was killed, she was made for a sin offering. She must be red. And 19th chapter of Exodus, if any of you like to read it. And she must be taken hoof all, burnt together. And then that was made a water of separation. It was set without the gates. It had to be handled with clean hands. The blood of this heifer went before to the congregation and stroked 7 times up over the door. And now every defiled person walking up must first recognize and see that blood and realize that there's only fellowship beneath that blood. That's the only place the worshiper that could actually worship officially was under the blood. Then the first thing he had to do before he could come under the blood, there had to be this water of separation sprinkled up on him. And the uncleansed was made clean. And they took the water of separation and sprinkled it up on the wayfaring man and separated him from his sins. And then he walked under these 7 stripes of blood and had fellowship with the rest of the believers in the presence of God. There's only one way to do it, not shaking hands, not joining church, not by baptisms, not by emotions, but walk up to the waters of separation. Lay your hands by faith upon the head of Jesus and say, I'm a sinner and you died in my place. And something in me tells me that you'll forgive me of my sins and I accept you as my personal Savior now. Walk beneath the blood and have fellowship with the children of God.
Amen.
That's it. Eat the bread, drink the wine, and have the fellowship with the church. Oh, isn't He wonderful? Isn't He good? Now, this may seem strange to you, friend, but what do I stand here and say these things for? Would I say them to try to make myself different from somebody else? If I do, then I need to repent. I'm saying it because God said it, because it's God's Word. And listen, there's coming a time, and now is, that when people are going from the east to the west trying to find the Word of God and can't find it.
Amen.
When you go into a meeting, the first thing you do, You go in there and they have a bunch of tongues and interpretations. And somebody raise up and keep quoting the scripture. And that's carnal.
Amen.
Absolutely. God said for us not to use vain repetitions. What about him? If he's wrote it once, you believe it. He don't have to say it again. Tongues and interpretations is right, but it's be a direct message to the church or to somebody. Not just carnal and things like that. And then you get ahead and all these other things. Sure, the other day, two men walked into a man and a wife and another man and a wife, just young married. Walked into a place to go to Africa as a missionary. Somebody stood up and gave a prophecy and gave tongues and interpretations that they had each other's wife. That it should not be that way. They married the wrong person. And those two people separated and remarried over again. One man took the other's wife, the other in a leading Pentecostal denomination. And went to Africa as missionary.
Lord,
brother, when you take your oath, your duty bound to that oath till death sets you free.
Amen.
Exactly right. Certainly when you take your oath, it's binding. All those nonsense. And it's got to a place that when you go to the churches, it's either so cold and formal and dry to the spiritual thermometer will go 50 below zero. The people sit just like a wart on a pickle, just as sour and indifferent and puckered up.
Amen.
And if you hear somebody way back in a corner might groan out a little, hey. Man, once in a while I can hear some. All of them stretch their neck like geese to look around and see what took place. You know that's the truth. I'm not saying that for a joke. This is no place to joke. That's the truth. Right. I'm saying it because it's a gospel truth. And the other side, you get a bunch of nonsense of a bunch of fleshly emotions carrying on. And the true word of God finally has got to a place to where you can seldom hear it. The old middle of the road, the gospel, the light to my path. Hallelujah. The blood of the Lamb, the love of God that separates us from the things of the world. Have you spoken tongues, brother? You haven't got it. Did you shout with a cold feeling went up your back? Did you see balls of fire? Oh, nonsense. No such a thing. Have you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ and accepted him as your personal Savior? And the Spirit of God bears record with your spirit that your sons and daughters of God in your life bears fruit of love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, meekness, gentleness. Then you're Christians. If it doesn't, I don't care what you do. Paul said, I can give my body to be burned as a sacrifice. I know all the mysteries of God. I can move mountains with my faith. I can speak in tongues like men and angels. I'm nothing.
Amen.
How about that?
Yeah.
1 Corinthians 13. Find out if that's right or not. Now find out if the 2 Corinthians 13, I believe it is. See the 1st or 2nd Corinthians? 1st Corinthians. That 1st Corinthians 13 is right. Though I speak with tongues of men and angels, both the kind that can be interpreted and that cannot be interpreted, I'm nothing. So what's use of fooling with it then? Right. Though I understand all the mysteries of God, what do you go to seminaries and try to learn so much about? You better get right with God first.
Amen.
Certainly. Though I, oh, bless the hallelujah, you got so you can't even have a congregation that's got a healing campaign or some kind of miracles going on. A weak and adulterous generation seeketh after such. What do you want with that? Paul said he could do all kinds of things, even move mountains, and still he's nothing. Where there's tongues, it shall cease. Where there's knowledge, it shall vanish. Where there's prophecies, it shall fail. But when that which is perfect is come, it shall endure forever, and love is perfection. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shivers, whosoever shakes, whosoever speaks, whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. Believe that, children. They try to make it so complicated, these things and them things, when it boils right down to one thing, your personal faith in God.
Amen.
That's it. That tells it. For by faith, not by feeling, by faith, not by emotion, by faith, not by sensation, but by faith are you saved, and that by? Because you sought the Lord. Because you're a good person. Because God, by grace, foreknew you and ordained you to eternal life. Jesus said, no man can come to me except my Father draws him. And all that comes to me, I'll give him eternal life. No man can pluck them from my hand. They're mine. They're forever saved. I got them. No man can pluck them out of my Father's hand. He is one given to me. They're love, gifts of mine.
Amen.
And all he foreknew, he called. He don't call anybody unless he foreknew him. All he called, he justified. All he justified, he glorified. So you see, we just a perfect rest. Now, I know there's a lot of legalists here, 99% of you. But look, if you'll just take this and realize, and I'm not trying to say you something that you say, well, Brother Branham, I've always taught I had to do this and I had to do that. There's such a difference in it, brother, in what you have to do and what you want to do. You are saved not because you had one thing to do with it. You're saved because that God saved you before the foundation of the world.
God bless you all. I greet you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. Let's all rise up to our feet as we sing, He paid a debt He did not owe. I owed a debt that I could not pay. For I needed someone to wash my sins away. I could not pay, I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, amazing grace all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. He paid a debt at Calvary. He cleansed my soul and set me free. I'm glad that Jesus did all my sins erase. I now can sing song, amazing grace all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. One day He's coming back for me to live with Him eternally. Won't it be glorious to see Him on that day? I then will sing a brand new song, amazing grace all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. He paid a debt, He paid at Calvary. He cleansed my soul and set me free. I'm glad that Jesus did all my sins erase. I now can sing, oh yes, a brand new song, amazing grace all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I, one day He's coming back for me. One day He's coming back for me to live with Him eternally. Won't it be glorious to see Him on that day? I then will sing a brand new song, amazing grace all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I could never pay. Amen. Before the opening prayer, let's sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us, How Vast Beyond Our Measure. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss! The Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon His shoulders, my sins upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in any, no gifts, no power, no wisdom. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my rent. I will not boast in anything. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. What should I gain from His? I cannot give an answer. I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Amen. Let's all rise for the opening prayer as we invite Brother Shanwu to open us with the word of prayer and pray for the offerings and the tithes, and commit the rest of the service into God's hands this morning.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we want to thank You once again this morning, resurrection morning, Lord, to be gathered under Your feet and under Your anointing this morning. We thank You, Heavenly Father, for the opportunity, Lord, to be in Your house once again. Lord Jesus, as we have sang this morning, Lord, we will not boast in anything, but in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, his death and his resurrection this morning, Lord, we have gathered, Lord, to check up with our soul salvation once again, to see where we are with you in our spiritual walk and journey with you. Lord, we want to ask this morning that you come down. Lord, and may you minister to every need this morning. Speak to us as your children. Lord Jesus, and we ask, Heavenly Father, whatever need, Lord, that will be represented this morning, because we know your word is sharp and powerful, and in the designer of the thoughts and intents of the heart. We ask, Lord, may your word discern our needs today. Lord Jesus, if there be any sin hanging anywhere in our lives, those that are here, those listening online, we pray, may every sin come under the blood, and let your spirit have free cause in our midst this morning. Bless the tithe and the offering. Lord, may it be used for the furtherance of your kingdom. Lord, and we ask, Heavenly Father, this morning, if there be any that is sick, Lord, in our midst, Lord, we ask before the end of the service, Lord, may you heal their bodies this morning. Lord, those that are looking for the Holy Ghost, those that are looking for a touch in their life, the backsliders, Lord, we pray, may you restore them through the preaching of your word this morning. We welcome you in our midst, Lord. We ask, Lord Jesus, at the end of the service, Lord, may we come back, Lord, and we have those demise experience that truly we have been in your house. Granted, Lord, bless the song leader this morning, bless the musician this morning, and all together may we all worship you in spirit and in truth. And when your servant will come to speak, we pray, Lord, that you move man out of the way. May you inspire him, release utterance unto him, and may he speak as the oracle of God this morning. Grant it, Lord, as we ask your blessing upon the service today. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen.
I welcome you all once again to the house of the Lord this morning. Just shake your neighbor and welcome them to the house of the Lord as your offerings go by. And for those online, for the offerings and the tithes, the Cash App handle is $CFTAB. As we sing, I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out.
So glad that the Lord brought me out. I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out. If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would I be? I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out. I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out. I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out. If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would I be? I'm so glad that the Lord brought. Aren't you glad that the Lord brought you out? Aren't you glad that the Lord brought you out? If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would you be? Aren't you glad that the Lord brought you out? I've been happy since the Lord brought me. I've been happy since the Lord brought me out. If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would I be? I've been singing since the Lord brought me out. I've been singing since the Lord brought me out. If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would I be? I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out. I'm so glad that the Lord I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out. If it had not been for Jesus, oh, where would I be? I'm so glad that the Lord brought me out. There are people almost everywhere whose hearts are all aflame with the fire that fell at Pentecost, which cleansed and made them clean. It is burning now within my heart. Oh, glory to His name. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. I'm one of them. Hallelujah, one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. I'm one of them. Hallelujah, one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Though these people may not learn to be no boast of earthly fame, they have all received their Pentecost, baptizing Jesus' name, and are telling now both far and wide His power is yet the same. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one. Are you one of them? Hallelujah, one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of, are you one of them? Praise the Lord, one of, I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. They were gathered in the upper room all praying in His name. They were with the Holy Ghost and power for service came. Now what He did for them that day, He'll do for you the same. I'm so glad that I can say I'm. Are you one of them? Praise the Lord, one of. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Hallelujah, one of. Amen, I'm one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Come my brother, seek this blessing that will cleanse your heart from sin, that will start the joy bells ringing and will keep your soul aflame. It is burning now within my heart. To His name. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them, one of. Praise the Lord, I'm one of. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Amen, I'm one. Hallelujah, one. Amen, I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Oh, He abides. Oh, He abides. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the. Oh, for the Comforter abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the pilgrim way. For the hand of God in all my life, and the reason of my bliss. Yes, the secret all is this, that the Comforter abides with me. He abides. Hallelujah, hallelujah, He abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me. Once my heart was full of sin, once I had no peace within, till I heard how Jesus died upon that tree. Then I fell down at His feet, and there came a peace so sweet. Now abides with me. Oh, He abides it. Hallelujah, He abides. Hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk. Oh, for the Comforter abides with me. He is with me, is with me everywhere, and he knows my every care. I'm as happy as a bird, and just as for the Spirit has control. Jesus satisfies my soul, since the Comforter abides with me. Oh, he abides, he abides. Hallelujah, hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me. There's no thirsting for the things of the world. They've taken wings long ago. I gave them up, and instantly all my night was turned to day. All my burdens rolled away. Now the Comforter abides with me. He abides, he abides. Hallelujah, hallelujah, he abides with me. Oh, I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Oh, this old world can never hold me. Any moment I'll be gone, for I've made my consecration, and I have my wording coming on. This old world can never hold me. Any moment I'll be gone, for I've made my consecration, amen, and I have the wedding garment on. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Oh yes, cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to. By and by, when the morning comes, oh yes, when all the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story, how we overcome. We will understand it better by and by. We are often tossed and driven on the restless, somber skies, and howling tempests of succeed a bright sunshine in that land of perfect day. When the mists have rolled away, we will understand it better by and by. By and by, by and by, when the morning comes, When all the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story how we overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the way that God will lead us to that blessed promised land. But He guides us with His eyes. We will follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by. Oh, by and by, by and by, when the morning comes. Oh yes, when all the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story how we overcome. We will understand it better by and by. When the roll is caught up yonder, when the roll is caught up yonder, I'll be there on that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise and the glory of His resurrection share. When His chosen shall gather to their home beyond the sky, and the roll is caught up yonder, will you be there? Chains of Satan, amen. I am delivered, praise the Lord. I am delivered, oh yes, praise the Lord. I am delivered by His word. Once I was bound by the chains of Satan, I am delivered, praise. Amen. Blessings and glory, wisdom, thanksgiving, and honor, power and might belongs to our God forever and ever. Amen. 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 Blessings and glory, wisdom, thanksgiving, and honor, power and might belongs to our God forever and ever. Amen, 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 amen. Wisdom, wisdom, thanksgiving, and honor, to our God forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. For the changing of the service, let's sing Amazing Grace. How sweet that sound. That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Amen. Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did, oh yes, that grace appear, that grace appear. The hour I first believed, through many dangers, has brought me saved thus far, and grace will lead me home. Praise God, praise God. Praise God, praise God.
Please may you have your seat this moment for a few minutes for these announcements. I would like to take this time to welcome everyone. Those are here this hour and also those are home. Anyone that is watching us and listening to us this morning, you are welcome, and may the Lord richly bless everyone this morning. Amen. Also, I would like to wish a happy Father's Day to all the fathers this morning. Amen. It's not easy to be a father, huh? May the Lord richly bless you. Amen. And give you the wisdom to take care of those children. Amen. Amen. And all the children, also the entire home. We've been talking about going back to Rosecraft, and our official day is starting on the July 1st, but that July 1st is a Thursday, and we will not be there on that July 1st. Because we need to clean the place, test our equipment, make sure everything is working fine before we start service.
So our beginning of service in person at Rosecroft is going to be on the 4th, which is going to be on Sunday, the 4th July. Amen. So 4th July, we will meet there by the grace of God. Church sitting time will be at 10 o'clock. As you, sorry, 9 o'clock. Amen. So 9 o'clock in the morning. Amen. We will just keep the time as it was before. We're not changing anything. That's going to be on the Sunday, on the 4th. And then before we go Saturday, we will be meeting there to clean, to maintain the place and get the place ready for Sunday. So we are throwing an invitation to anyone that will make it, anyone that will come on that Saturday, the 3rd, to help clean and arrange the chairs and the pulpit and all those things so that we'll be ready for Sunday. Anyone that wants to come is welcome. Amen. Also, we've been talking about a memorial service for our precious brother. Some will call him father. Some will call husband, son. But there's one thing we know. He was a soldier. He fought for this gospel. He preached and he lived by it. We will have a memorial service for Brother Marion on the 10th July at Rosecroft. And the sitting time is 10 o'clock. Let us mark our calendars for this event. Also, our Sunday school this week, the PVSA part 8. And we will continue reading our Bible verse, Hebrew 13, verse 8. We have prayer requests. Please keep our brothers that have traveled, keep them in prayers. I know Joke also is out there. Just in case the Lord make a way for him to preach somewhere, let him be a blessing to somebody over there. Amen. Anyone they meet over there, let them be a blessing also. And also pray that the Lord will bring them home safe. Also, Brother Modest, I heard he's doing very well. The Lord is hearing our cry. So let us keep on praying for Brother Modest and also the children. Amen. And this morning we have Brother Peter Kambamba that will speak for us. So not taking too much time, let us invite Brother Peter to come forward this morning. Let us be on our feet, please. And as we sing the song, Amazing Grace, keep me singing this morning, amen. Help me sing. In grace,
Our mighty God, our Lord Jesus Christ, we praise you this morning. There is no anybody like you, Lord. We know you are our Father. We know you are the one who provides to our need. Jesus Christ, this morning, as a family, one accord, we come in front of you, Lord. Surrender ourselves to you. Come and preach to us. Come and bless us. Come and correct us, O Lord. We commit this time to your hand, O Lord. Come and take a preeminence from the beginning to the end of our service. We are going to read your word, O Lord. We want you to come and give us, O Lord, inspiration. Come and bless your people, O God, through your word, O Lord Jesus Christ. Because outside, O Lord, there's nothing that can give us life. It's only through your word that we can receive life. Through your word that we can connect to you, O Lord. Bless this moment. We ask in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let God bless you.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.
I am one. You are more than one. Amen. That means that your voice might be more than me. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.
Okay. So let's open our Bible to the book of John 5, 35, 36. When you go to the house of the Lord, it's not you are going to the prison. Amen? When you are going to the house of the Lord, you are not going to the prison. Amen?
Amen.
You are going to see your Father. You are going to talk to your Father. Anything you need of God will give you.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
So let you just be happy when you are going to the house of the Lord. Because we know one saint says in the Bible, I was happy when I was going to the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
So when you are going to the house of the Lord, just be happy. We say John 5, 35. John 5, 35. Oh, let's start from 34. But I receive no testimony from man, but those things I said, that he might be saved. He was a burning and a shining light, and he was willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John, for the works which the Father had given me to finish, the same works that I do, be a witness of me that the Father had sent me. Amen. So let's go to Act 1, 4, 8. Act 1, 4, 8. Act 1, 4, 8. The Bible says this. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which said he have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Let God add more blessing on the reading of the word. You may be seated. God richly bless you. Let me just add something to the fathers before we go to what I prepare. Amen? So because we know all the brothers here, all the brothers, be married or not, you are a father. Be married. Where David?
Right.
Brother David? You a father. Okay? You are just waiting for the time to come. And then we'll call you a father. Okay? Now we are the father now. But you wait, your time will come. Exo and Brother Daniel or others, Brother Fukumi as well too. So wait, your time will come. But now you also a father. In you, you have your children, okay? But when time comes, and then, but for now, we are wishing those who want to have children. Amen? We are wishing them happy Father's Day, like Brother Sasu says. But I have one quote I would like to read before I go to what God put in my heart to share with you. Let me see. Brother, Project Spiritual Adoption, 5609-23, paragraph 84. So because we don't have time, let me just read from here, and then when you project, it will be easy for those when they are home or those when they cannot clearly catch my pronunciation. So sometimes my pronunciation is like English, like French, so it's mixed up. So, but when they project, it helps you a lot. And also 84, paragraph 84. And sometimes also Brother John is my backup. Okay? Yeah. Okay, let me read here. When I was a boy, my daddy was different from what some of the modern fathers are today. My daddy believed in giving whippings, and he really gave them. We remember them, and I, yet today, over 47 years, I remember them. But it done me good. Amen. It trained me. If I could go to the grave today and raise him up, the first thing I'll do will shake his hands and hug him for what he done. That's for the father. Flowers, yes. Weeping, yes. So if the children, they don't listen, just a little one. So with love. So when they grow, what about what think about his father? So also where you not be there, they might think about you. Oh, if I'm what I am today is because of my father. If I am what I am today is because of my father. Because sometimes we have some remembrance. Sometimes we think about our father. Oh, my dad was telling me this, my dad was telling me this. But if you, dad, you are no home, if you, dad, you don't have time to talk to your children, how your children, they will remember that? They will just say, oh, you know, our dad was no home. Our dad was no home. Just be home, have time, talk to your children. Talk to them. Amen? Amen. Father's Day. So, get inside the Father's Day and then know what does it mean. So today, God put in my heart to share with you this sermon that was preached on 530405. That was a witness. We want to talk about a witness. But I went through some quotes as well, and then just to have a good food to give it to you. So it's like I went to three witnesses, testimony of a true witnesses, and then some quotes as well, and reading some Bibles, also verses. So meet them together. So that will be my sermon this morning with you. So, but I will emphasize more on the true witnesses. A true witness. I think all of us here, we want to be a witness. All of us here. Amen. Nobody will say, I don't want to be a witness. But your action, your attitude, what you say, will show us that you are a true witness or you are not a true witness. Your action, how you behave, how you act, will tell us if you are a true or you are not a true witness. Okay, now the prophet says, there are two kinds of witnesses. There's the one who can see what's happened, or someone can hear what they talk. Not somebody that they've told him, but you yourself, you have seen it, or you yourself, you have heard about it. That is a true witness. Amen. Not somebody, not the life of your father, not the life of your friend. No, yourself to be a witness. So is what we want to talk this morning. Today, will you bear with me? I'll just go. I do not have time to print. I'll just go here and here. But I will do my best not to keep you long. Okay, you cannot be a true witness if you are not at the place of the incident occurred.
That's right.
Amen? If there's an accident on the road, they will ask for the witness. Oh, no, oh, that's passing, I hear some boom. No. You need to go. You go to the court. You give evidence. Like, when I was there, I saw this. I heard this. He's the one who said it. Not they told me. No, my father told me. Or this brother told me. That you are not a true witness. And when somebody is reporting to you, and you are going to report to somebody else, like it or no, it's not the same story.
Amen.
And be careful when somebody is coming to you, telling you, you know, when I was in the church, they said it, they said this. I was talking to this brother. That brother says this. Be careful. First of all, ask yourself a question. That's me. I always ask this question. You are telling me what that brother said, right? But what you said yourself, you are not telling me. You see? You come with the story. You know, when I was talking to Brother Mala, you were saying this, Brother Mala was saying, yes. Now the question is, how do you come to that point? Because it's supposed to be something, and then brought that topic. So you need to find out what was before they come to that point, your name in that story. Amen? That's why the problem is. If you are not clear, you are not smart, or you are not wise, they will drag you to some story that you don't have the head, you don't have the leg. You just eat because they will say, and then you go fight for nothing. This is why we need to be wise. You need to be a true witness, yes. Just be careful. Listen to the story yourself. You see it. Otherwise, they'll say, oh, this brother said this. That brother said this. That one said this. There'll be a confusion. Now, to be a true witness is not just you wake up today and then you become a witness. No. In the physical realm, like in the world that we are living, you need to see something and then hear something and then you can witness. In the courts, they ask you, you have some evidence, like this is the evidence, this is the evidence. What the judge is looking is just the evidence. It's not your good talking. No, it's the evidence. I was arrested. This is the convocation or the no, when they send some letter to call it to the court. Summon.
Yes.
See, this is the sermon I was asked to come to the court. Or this is the invitation. This is the appointment letter. So those are the evidence in the self, like physical, the way that we are living now. But in the spiritual side also, we need to be witnesses about God. We need to witness about what God does in our life. So for you to witness what God does in your life, there must be some qualification. You need to be qualified for you to be a witness. You cannot just wake up today, oh, I'm a witness of God. No. You need to be born again.
Amen.
You need to have the Holy Ghost. When you have the Holy Ghost in you, then you can testify about God. Then you can be a good witness to God. Amen. You know, Jesus Christ himself, he called the disciple. Himself was choosing them. Among those disciples, Judah was there. Mm-hmm. Amen. Judah was also among the disciples. Is it Judah a witness?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we said to be a witness, you need to have the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
Now, Judah, when it came to time to have the Holy Ghost. He did not have the Holy Ghost. Amen. But you and me, if we want to testify about what God is doing today, you need to have the Holy Ghost. Amen. Then you cannot just testify or witness about God if yourself you don't have an experience with God.
That's right.
You need to have experience with God. And then you can testify about Him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, amen. So the prophet say that experience, it become, okay, if you are testifying for God, okay, when you are be born again, is automatically. It become automatically. It's not something you need to fake it. To witness about God is automatically. Not something that you wake up and you tell, oh no, I need to be like this, I need to be like this. No, you are not the one making you to be like this. It's God Himself in you that make you to be like Him. Amen. So, the day of Pentecost, Jesus Christ told the disciple, don't go far. Wait until you receive the Holy Spirit. Now, when the Holy Spirit came, while they was waiting, they not changed their life. They not say like, let me just start wearing like this. Let me just start talking like this. No. They waited. When the Holy Ghost came in them, now they went out to do what? To testify. To be the witness, to witness about God. It's the Holy Ghost in them that pushed them to go and witness about God. Now, when the people, they see them, those people that are talking to our language, they are speaking to our language, but they are not from our side. What makes like that, what makes like that is the Holy Ghost in them. Because themselves, they surrender themselves to God. They say, God, use us. And then God use them the way God wants to use them. Not you, the way you want God to use you. But the way God wants to use you. Amen.
Amen.
So, let's project paragraph 48. A witness. 5304-05, paragraph 48. But before we go, he's projecting the quote. Let me make some a small comment here. Everybody here has his eyes, right? So now, when something is coming, you want to enter to your eyes. I think the eyelash, eyelash, kink, right? Automatically, right? That's the way God make you. But now look, your hands come late. You have experienced that? When something want to enter to your eyes, your eyelash just, but your arms comes late.
Okay.
Project that quote. I was waiting for you to project. My comment was coming that quote. I think you are used to the way I preach, right? My English as well. Okay. Let's read this one. Okay. And God help us to see the day that when men will be just what they are. You know, I am. I say this now with all respect. I can't see. It isn't our city full of bootleg joints that are hurting us. Here is what is hurting us more than ever. It's people who are professing to be Christians and not living like it. Okay? Today, you hear people, I'm a Christian, I'm born again, I'm this and that. That's fine. Are you a true witness? Because a true witness will project the life of Christ. But you see that their life doesn't convince you that they are Christian. That's the problem today. That is the thing. See, they are not a correct witness. Go down. Okay. They can't witness until they have an experience. And when they have an experience, then they become a witness. Automatically. Okay? Because they are born again. It's not something that you need to work on it. You know you. When you are born again, you want to witness about God automatically because the Holy Spirit is in you. It's not something you fake. Amen. The eyes, the eyeglass automatically, poof. That's not your controlling. God himself. The same thing when Holy Ghost is in you, when the life of Christ in you, you produce what is Christ. It's not something you try to make yourself. Because if you make it yourself, you fail. It is why you see some brothers, you see some sisters, when they come here, we warm them. We warm them. When we are warming them, they have that high temperature, right? But when they go where it's cold, they become cold. They become cold. They will act like us. They will talk like us. But they don't have that experience with God. But if yourself, you have experience with God, wherever you go, you see the same brother, you see the same sister. Reason why some people, when they're coming from Africa, some coming not from United States, people, they think that, oh, we know there's no good brothers, we know there's no, they don't preach well, they're not. No, they are. They true Christian, they are in America. The true preacher, they are in America. Those ones, they live the word of God. They live the life of Christ. They are in America. One brother was telling me, he said, you know, I was talking with my brother today in the car when we are coming. We share about the word of God sometimes. You know, I was telling me, look, one brother was telling me one time, he said, Brother Peter, I don't like to say my name, but he just can't want to put the name of Brother Mala over there. Because sometimes it's me, but I put the name of Brother Mala. Or sometimes one brother here, I put that name. So it's like that, but my name come out, it's fine. So you are telling me, you know, brother, if you don't go to heaven, I will not go to heaven. That is a strong statement. Yes. See, brother, if you don't go to heaven, I will not go to heaven. I just laugh. But me, I will tell you this. Go to heaven, you need to be pre-elect. Coming to church, I can be hypocrite. Coming to church, I can quote you, quote. Okay? But if I don't produce the life of Christ, I'm just making noise. Amen. If I am not born again, I'm just making noise. If I don't have a good experience, I'm just making noise. Myself, I know where I'm weak. You don't know where I am weak. But when I'm with you, I do my best to be a good brother. But I know my level. But that cannot be my excuse. I need to work on it. Amen. Until I come to the image of the perfect man. Amen. 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 So we need to have that. Don't say, I will not tell you that you go to heaven. I will not tell you. I will say, myself, I will go to heaven. Because I don't know really, really who you are. Mm-hmm. But I trust you. I love you. Mm-hmm. But what you do when you are by yourself, I don't know. You can see couples, husband and wife. You think like, oh, this is a good couple. This is a good couple. But you don't know. Maybe it's the wife, the sister. Who make it like that outside? Let me just pretend that I love this brother. But what the brother is doing to that sister, you don't know. Deal with your things. Deal with your stuff yourself. We have the book. We have the message book. Read and handle your matters. Don't think like that brother is better than me. You can be better than that brother. You can have your own experience with God. And God can lead you, because he said that, I am going to prepare a place, I will send you the Holy Ghost. And the prophet said, the Holy Ghost, that's the true witness. Now the Holy Ghost is God. The Holy Ghost is the word of God. The Holy Ghost in you, he will lead you to the true, to the truth. Or you don't have the Holy Ghost. Because if you have the Holy Ghost, he will lead you to the truth.
Amen.
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 Now, let's go to another one. When you are born again, you have the Holy Ghost in you. Let me say one thing again. If you want, my brother also, we were talking. He said, there are some preaching, that is a practical preaching. That one, we need to see it. We are not thinking about it. We see it, and then we mark. But there are some preaching just for your knowledge. Amen? That one I can, oh no, but I'm going to say this. Yeah, that's for your knowledge. But we want to see the life. Life is no knowledge. Amen? Life is no knowledge. Life is something true. We see it. Because the Bible, they said, you know, you recognize them by their fruits. And the Bible said that, what you sow, so what you sow is what you reap. Yes, what you sow is what you reap. And in the book of Genesis, the Bible says that, let any seed bring forth the same thing. So if you are maize, you sow the maize, don't expect the mango to come out. Amen. Don't expect the mango to come out. If you have the Holy Spirit in you, God in you, people, they will see it. Remember, the prophet said, if everybody have a Holy Ghost, there's no need to preach order in the church. Amen. But because we have three kinds of believers, the pastor needs to repeat. And the deacon needs to be behind that to enforce that. That the one of the job description of the deacon too. They need to emphasize the order in the church. But if everybody have the Holy Ghost, there's no need. Yeah. On the street, the same thing. Court, the same thing. There will not be matters in the court. Because of what, everybody have the Holy Ghost. But what is the matter today? People, they don't have Holy Ghost. They pretend they have the Holy Ghost, but they don't have it. Amen. So the prophet said this. Prepare at that word, like 480305, paragraph 18. So when we are born again, you have experience with God. It doesn't stop there. Because you want to witness about God. You want to witness about what God has done in your life. Amen? And God will not leave you like that. The devil also will not leave you like that. Amen? There will be some trials. My brother, if you are ready, you project, and then I will read it from there too. There are some trials. There will be some temptation. Okay. Let's read there. It will help us a lot. Now let's read this quote here. You understand that when you are born again, the experience with God will be temptation. When God himself can let you be sick, yourself, God himself, let something happen to your life. He can let like, you can be sick for you to go to that experience. And then after that, after your healing, now you can testify. Now you can be a witness. Like God said this, when he was at the cross of Calvary, he said, I am the one Who heals you? That's just the word. That word now manifests in your life. Because you have heard that. You heard that. In the church, we come and say, God is a healer. Did you just hear that? God is a healer. For you to witness that God is a healer, you need to be sick.
That's right.
When you are sick, now you have evidence. Like, I was sick. God heals me. Amen. Now you can talk with evidence. Amen.
That's right.
Amen. So just read that one. Then when he come out here to the side of the mount, isn't that something? Believe the apostle said that our trials are better than gold to us. Think of it. God might let you get sick. Amen. Oh, no, it's my uncle who did this. Oh, it's my co-worker. No. It's not your uncle. It's not your co-worker. It's God letting that to happen to you. Why? Because you are son of God. You are his son. Some places where prophets say that if you don't want to come to God, you don't want to give your life to God, you don't want to pray, what God will do? He'll give you some sickness for you to, good. To bring you closer to him. Amen? But if God gives you that, he's want to see something after that.
That's right.
You remember in the Bible, there was one boy was born blind.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yep.
They bring him to the disciples. Is it him or is it the father?
No.
He said, no. Why? For the glory of God to be what? Seen.
That's right.
Okay? So now people, they can have that like evidence.
Yep.
My son was blind. Now he can see. Remember, Thursday also we read something like that in the Bible.
Yeah.
Where that blind, that we cannot go to the water.
Yeah.
Now when Jesus Christ came, he said, take your bed and go and walk. When he meet people, he said, no, today is a Sabbath day. Well, he said, the one who told me, that is the witness.
Yeah.
That's the evidence.
Yeah, right.
Amen. We cannot talk about Christianity if we don't have evidence.
Yeah.
My brother, since you believe the message, you don't have evidence that God has done something to your life. That is you, nobody. That is yourself.
Right.
Like, God, I am your son. And then you can take that, say, devil, you're a liar. Because I was sick, and then I was healed.
Yeah.
I am the witness of what God said. Today, people, they are not witnessing because of what? Because they don't know the word of God.
Yeah.
Why can you witness something that you never seen? Can you witness something that you never hear? We hear the word of God every day. And we see also miracle every day. And then we are true witness. And then he said, God might let you get sick in order that you might be a testimony. That he might heal you, that you can stand on his word. Because you have the evidence. Then, when you reach the opposition, you can say. Because the people, they will come to oppose you. Now, you might be able to say this, I know. Beyond any shadow of doubt, you are. Oh my, witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. A witness is somebody who's really done something. Been somewhere and seen something. Is it that right?
Amen.
That is a witness. God in your life. Let's have negative testimony. Don't have negative thoughts. God has done something in your life? Yes. That one you become a witness. Because you have said this, you have done this. That's to be witness to God. Now, when you witness to God, God has done this to my life. Don't think like you are done. That's the end. No, there might be some suffering. You can suffer. Something can come to you, to your road, because that road is not easy. Today, God can heal you, and tomorrow you get sick again. Amen. But you have something in your hands that you can say, yesterday I was sick. Even though today I'm sick, I know my God is a healer.
Amen.
Paragraph 7, 8. The same sermon. God is good, right?
Amen.
We love him. Sometimes when something happens to your life, some people, when you talk to them, they think that they are uncle. Oh, is my uncle did this? When I call my uncle did this. But as in our side, we don't say that. In our side, we know it's God who did it. Amen. 7, 8. Yeah, no. The same, the many, God, yes. So, when you witness for God, God has done something to me, my brother, my sister, prepare yourself that you can suffer also. Then there is something, there is sometimes a penalty. God's with a witness. Sometimes when you witness for God, you have to suffer a little bit. Amen. You are going to school. You are going to work. You are going somewhere. Your position, your attitude will make people to talk bad about you. You are witnessing about God. Because God said, cover your body. And now you are all wearing a long skirt. You are in school, now people are laughing at you. Why? Because you are witnessing what God said. Amen? Don't think that when you wear the long skirt, people, they will not laugh at you. They will laugh at you. Now, when they're laughing at you, you keep quiet. Don't murmur in your heart. Just pray, God, forgive them. Because they don't know what they are doing. Amen? So, my brother, I don't want people to see me all the time. I want that to be there. Okay. Now, you remember, when mother told you that you could stay around home, as long as you read the Bible and carry on, or some of the neighbors said, oh, the children said at school, you was a fanatic or something, because you was a true witness. Remember, on the job, how all the men laughed at you because you was a real witness. See? How on the streets you were made fun of when you give a testimony. But that's a genuine sign of a real, true witness. God wants witness. Amen. So you and me, don't be afraid. Now go to 82. Now, when you're in front of temptation, trials, my brother, my sister, do not murmur. Because the problem is sometimes you have a good time with God. You have a good experience with God. But now, what is in front of you? You start murmuring. Make sure the devil. Remember, the prophet said, as soon as you get baptized, the devil is there to fight you. He's there to fight you. Just as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Just as soon as Israel came out under the blood, circumcised, the Holy Spirit leading them in a form of a light, right as light straight up to the Red Sea, and there, called mountain on one side, desert on the other, Pharaoh army coming, and the Red Sea cutting them off, God led them right up to that place. Why? To get glory. Then Moses prayed, and God told him to step right on down toward the Red Sea, holding his stick out in front of him. And as he walked, the Red Sea moved from one side to the other, right across the Red Sea. Why? God's path led through. Amen. So now, when you go down, you see that even though they crossed the Red Sea, there is not a time when children of Israel, they start murmuring, even though they have that experience. They start murmuring, and God doesn't want that. God doesn't want the Christian that has chameleon spirit. Today you are happy because God has blessed you. Tomorrow when in front of temptation and then you say, oh no, you start murmuring. God doesn't want that kind of spirit.
Amen.
In the paragraph 67, that God is giving the example of the three Hebrew children. They have a good testimony. They know who told them. They know who they have met. Now, when the temptation came, there was no shaking. There was no shaking. Why the prophet is saying that? In the okay, it's okay, it's okay. God, 67.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, I think we need to go down. Just take from places over there down where the prophet is saying that God wants his witness to be stern. Not a witness today and tomorrow they are wishy-washy. Okay. And I want you to notice this. God wants his witnesses to be stern. Not a witness today and wishy-washy tomorrow. Today, because God has blessed you, you clap your hand, you come to church, and then everything is fine. But when the temptation comes to you, and then you change your mind, oh, no, I don't believe anymore, because. Our life, we need to face those temptations. Yeah. Amen. We need to live to face them every day. Now, in the message of Hebrew, the prophet said, your nature prove who you are. There are some people, they cannot stand in front of temptation. He loved the husband when the husband was saving money. When there is no money, he changed the color. No submission anymore. No, when you took me, you know, my father. No, you are not at your father's house. Now, this is our house. When things are very difficult, just witness what I have done to you. Are you a witness that when things were going on, when going out? Yes, just still have the same attitude. Don't change, okay? Now, remember, in the book of Genesis 1:11, okay? The seed need to be planted. The seed need to be planted. And it can produce the fruit of its kind. Okay, you have planted me. That one I already said it about it. Now the prophet said, every son of God, daughter of God, son of God, the nature testify who you are. When things are very nice, sweet, we will not know your nature. We will not. You know, we were together, right? At our church place. How could you know Brother Mala could react like this if the pastor did not pass? Sometimes it's, let me tell you, we will not, if I cannot forget about my father, I think about him. That's biological father. I don't have a clue if I'll meet him in the heaven or I don't meet him in the heaven. But because I love him, I would just say, I'll meet him in the heaven. Right? Because of the love. But the one who testifies, the one who says is God himself.
That's right.
Amen.
That's
so, right. What I want to say by that is this. I trust more. My father was a Catholic, was a Protestant. So, that's why I say that. But Brother Marion is a message believer. So, that means that I have confidence that what he has done, I don't doubt. Okay?
Amen.
So I don't doubt. I don't doubt. It's God who have the key, the final key, but me, I don't doubt about his life. I have a testimony. Okay? I am a witness. We have talked. We have shared. So we will not forget about him. But let me tell you, church, if we don't, sometimes we don't talk about him, it's just for the emotion. We don't want to be emotional every time. You know, reason why sometimes we just take the page, we just keep it like that. Because it's still, the wound is still fresh. Okay? It's still fresh. So, but I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you. Be strong. Okay? So, if the pastor did not pass, we will not know the nature of many people. We will not. God allows something to happen. But in our side, we feel, oh no, why God did this? It was for a purpose. For you to know who is that brother Mala, who is that sister Mala. For you to know. Amen. So, I close that bracket. My brother, my sister, you cannot produce Christ.
That's right. Amen.
You cannot.
Amen.
The prophet was giving an example. You were talking about Brebi in English. Brebi. Sheep. Oh, yeah. Thank you. So, the prophet was talking about the sheep. He said, the sheep cannot produce. Like, oh, I want to produce the... No, mechanically, no. Okay? It just happened like that. That's like our life need to be like that. A Christian doesn't produce Christ, not at all. No. It's the Holy Ghost in you. Amen? Now the people, they can see. It's not you talking. Like, no, you don't make a noise. I have Christ. You know, no. Don't testify about yourself. Amen? Let people testify about you. Amen. You know, Jesus Christ, sometimes he can heal somebody. He tell, don't say to people, just don't talk to anybody. But because it's a testimony, you cannot keep it by yourself.
Yeah.
If they done something good to you, like it or no, you tell people. You tell people. Now, what we believe is what we produce. What you believe is what you produce. You can say amen. Yes. Okay? But when now you are in front of the situation, that is the time we will notice, are you a true witness or not? We have seen a lot. This brother is a holy brother. And when you go to the house, you see the pictures. I've seen brothers, they took the staff from church. I've seen brothers, they beat in the pastors. But that one was a good brother. You see? That's the past experience. But in front of the real one, it shows his color. Because what is in you, you show it up. And the people, they will see. They will say, oh, this brother. Is it the same brother? Yes, it's the same brother. But he was acting like he believed. He was acting like because of some interest. When there is no those interests, you see how the brother will act. You see how the sister will act. Now you yourself, you understand. Amen. Because in you, you need to have the Holy Ghost. If you have the Holy Ghost, in any kind of situation,
amen.
Any kind of situation,
amen.
It's not you acting. It's the Holy Ghost in you acting.
Amen.
It's not you. Like I gave the example of eyelash. It's not you, the arm, no. It's not you acting, no. It's God in you acting.
Amen.
Any situation. It's automatically. It's already set there. You know something you prepare. They, oh, why should I answer? No. Your life become Christ. The way you talk, the way you, everything you do is Christ in you. Because we have a promise. He said, I'll be with you. I'll be in you. Now, when God is in you, you think that you see the man, the body comes in you? How the body can enter in you? It's the word of God. When the word of God is in you, the spirit that God promised, the last, the end time, that spirit in you will lead you. And then you produce what is in you. If you were in the beginning, at the beginning it was the word. And then that word cannot stop. Amen. That word cannot stop. In your journey, that word will continue manifesting that God have said something. God have said this. God have said. In any kind of situation, yourself, you stand and say, oh, God said this. God said this. Automatically. And the people, they will testify about you. You see, the prophet Isaiah. The prophet Isaiah prophesied about Jesus Christ. That was in the past, in the Old Testament. And the prophet said, the prophet is not there to argue. The prophet is there to carry what God said and come give it to the people. That's the role of the prophet. So Isaiah, they gave him, God told him, there will be a time when a virgin will conceive. Isaiah could have discussed with God. How can a virgin conceive? That doesn't make sense. And people, they will laugh at me. Isaiah did not argue. Because it's not his word. It's the word of God. It's the God who says so. Isaiah did not ask when it's going to happen. He did not ask all those questions. He just took it and then come and say, Isaiah 9, 5, 6. Isaiah 7, 14. The virgin will conceive, will give a son. His name will be Emmanuel. Full stop. That one, people, they've heard about it. But we are waiting for the manifestation of what they said. Now you can be a witness. When John the Baptist saw Jesus Christ, and then John said, John was referring to what Isaiah said. For the testimony to be a true testimony, for the testimony to be a true testimony, there's true part to be done. There's a man, that was Isaiah, who prophesies. Amen. There is God, because God is a word. Isaiah prophesies about the word of God. Amen. He said, there shall be a son. A virgin must conceive. That's the word of God. Okay? Now, is that the second step? Now, God was prophesied. Isaiah prophesies God. Now the third one is God himself coming to perform or to fulfill what the prophet said. You might hear the Bible says, by his stripes you were healed. Amen. That's the word of God. Amen? They prophesied that. That's the word of God. Now you, the center, you take that word. Now God needs to come to manifest that word in you. Now you can testify. Amen. The same thing. Maybe you know, catch me well. Let me come go back to another example. The disciple, they received the word from God. God told them, go, wait to the upper room. Okay? That was the instruction God gave them. So them, they were like a people. That was what the main center. The band now is getting the word of God in them. They were waiting. But now they need to come in the spirit to come to perform or to fulfill what God has said. He said, the Holy Ghost will come upon you, and then you go to Jerusalem, to Samaria, everywhere you go, you testify about me. Testify about what? About God. About the Holy Spirit in them. Now, when they went out, remember, in Mark, God told them, go preach the word of God. Those ones that will believe, baptize them in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. That time, they did not receive the Holy Ghost. So, because they told them, don't go out. Stay. Amen. So, all the instruction from God, God can tell you something, but there's sometimes you need to do, you need to wait the appropriate time for you to go act on what God said. And then when you act what God said, now you become a witness. And it will not fail. What most of the time we fail? Because we are in a hurry. God told me, yes, we believe that God told you. But what that was it the appropriate time for you to act like that? Amen? If it was not the right time to act like you fell, because God is not there. You remember Moses? Moses fell also. Because that was not the right time. But he was the right person.
Amen.
What he said was true.
That's true.
But was not the right time.
Amen.
Amen. For you to be a true witness, wait and wait upon God.
Amen.
They dream, yes. They dream about you, yes. They about you, yes. They talk about you, yes. That's fine. But now wait.
Amen. Amen.
For you to be a true witness.
Amen.
Because God will need to come and confirm what he said.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you rally, you fail. The time of Isaiah, they were virgin. They protect themselves. They say, no, I will not go to that one. I want to keep myself to be clean. But because God was not in, because they want to produce that themselves. Oh, you must wait upon God to come in you so God can produce something. Even the love. Don't fake your love. It's automatically. My brother is automatically. You know, I don't know how to explain it.
Yeah.
But yourself, maybe you've passed those experiences. Somebody can ask you something. Automatically say, oh, don't take it. You tend to be thinking. Somebody can do something wrong to you. Can hurt you. You just, I forgive him. What people, they can come and say, no. You need to just say, go to court. But yourself, in you have peace. You say, no, I already forgive him. That's the witness that we want.
Yep.
Somebody who can produce really love. The Lord God Christ, Jesus Christ in you, and then people, they can see that love. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians 3:14-18. While he's projecting that, the prophet said, the nature also testify about God, the church. You see, in the winter, the flowers fall, there's no life on the tree. But that does not mean that there's no life. The life goes to the roof, the roots, and then stays there, waiting the season, waiting the right season for that to come again and then to bring the flowers. Amen. The same thing like us. Ephesians 3:14-18. For this cause, I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he will grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that he, being rooted and grounded in love. Love doesn't cease at all. Dog doesn't cease. If you have love in you, my brother, everywhere you go, you leave a good testimony.
Amen.
Everywhere you go, because you have love. Love is Christ. Christ in you. Everywhere you go. People, they might talk bad about you. People, they can say whatever they want to say. But if you have love in you, like it or not, the day you will not be there, they will testify about you. Sometimes in our family, people, they don't testify about us. They say, oh, if I testify about you, you'll be proud. You feel like he's the one. In the church, the same thing. Oh, yeah, he's the one. No. If you have love in you, those things will not affect you. Like it or no, we talk about others. Like it or no, we talk about others. But now look, the advice. The advice is, don't talk in the wrong way. Don't talk negativity about that brother. Talk positively, right? If the brother is like, oh, that brother is very smart. That brother is spiritual. You know, when he's in church, the way he say amen, the way he sing. Yes, we can talk about those things. But if you want to come to bring some negative story about the brother to tarnish the image of that brother, no, do that. Amen. Don't do that. That is not a good testimony. I want to be a good witness. So a good witness is with the word of God. So now when you come to me with not the word of God, I will not be the witness. Come to me with the word of God and we can testify. When the Holy Spirit is in you, you go out. You go preach the word of God. You are not going with the gossip. You go with the word of God to preach to people. And God himself, because God said it, God will come and then manifest himself with what you are doing. But if you are gossiping, God will not come and then manifest. Because you are gossiping. The result will be what? Yourself. You pay the price. The word of God. Joel said it. He said that in the last time, your people, your children, you prophesy, you see vision. That was what the Joel said. Amen? That was manifest. He became the people, they were witnesses about what Joel said. The day of Pentecost, they witnessed about what Joel said. And the word of God, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What he has done to the Pentecost people, the disciple, God is still able to do it today. Amen. So in our midst, we need to have vision. In our midst, we need to have those people that can produce what Joel said. The word that Joel said was not the word of Joel. But the word of God in Joel. And he cannot cease. He continues up to today. And today God himself can come because he wants to have witness. God wants to have witness. You take that word of God. You are in the center. That word, God now will come and manifest that word for you to be a witness of what Joel said. You see how the things of God works? You take what God said like a promise of God. You take it to become yours. Amen? And God will come, manifest what you have taken in your heart. And then you will be the witness of what that prophet said. And today God sent the prophet. God sent the prophet to prepare us. Okay? What the prophet said is the word of God. You take that word prophet said. Believe what the prophet said. And God will come, manifest what you believe.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
It's not, but we have heard what the prophet said. We have seen some video of what the prophet also did. We become a witness. But it cannot stop there. You need to have your own experience with God. And God needs to come, because you believe something, God needs to come to make it manifest it.
That's right.
To make it real in your life. Then you can say that, oh, I believe this message is true. Because the prophet said this. I put my faith on what the prophet said.
Yep.
And then God come and then manifest that.
Amen.
That's the experience that we need.
Amen.
That's the experience we want to go through. If you never had that experience, I am telling you this morning, God still alive.
Amen.
I'm telling you this morning that God needs witnesses.
Amen.
For you to witness about God, you need to believe what God said through the mouth of his prophet. Believe it, and then God will come, manifest what you believe. If you believe that there will be a rapture, you believe there will be a rapture, God will come and manifest that. If you believe there will be a resurrection, God will come and manifest the resurrection.
Amen.
If you believe that I will be healed, God will come and then manifest your healing. Yeah. If you believe whatever, anything that you believe, that you have heard, because the faith comes by hearing. Anything you have heard about the word of God, take it like personal. That is me. Yourself in the center. Now God will come and manifest that.
Amen.
And then you say, I'm the witness. Because in the Bible they say this. Because in the message they say this. Now I've seen it myself. If somebody comes and then says, no, brother, you know, you never experienced. I am telling you, I have experience with my God. Because God said this, I believe it, now it's happened. Full stop. Amen. So those are the kind of witness we want to be.
Amen.
I want to read the conclusion. And then we'll pray. Let me, before I read the conclusion, read something here. God in you. You want to make your witness. In you. You cannot accept yourself to fall. Yourself. You say, oh, now I want to fall. If you don't have power, you are weak. You will be willing somebody to come rescue you. If you are on the road and then your car got stuck, when people are passing, you are, ah, God, somebody cannot stop here. Okay. If somebody stop, you know how you feel yourself. Amen. Let's read this quote, and then you understand what I make that comment. Hebrew, chapter 7, number 1, paragraph 92. We read it this morning, too. So, there were some quotes also I was preparing, but when I was reading the prophet, I would just say, oh God, thank you. And some song also, I feel good. I say, okay, that's fine. So the prophet said this here. No matter what the brother has done, you will do all you can to bring him back into the fellowship of Christ again. No matter what he's done, you will try hard. They say you try one time and then you know. No. You will try hard. You say, oh, brother, you know what? I testified to this brother, my love. I came to him. I've talked to him, but I can't. Another brother, the same thing. Another brother, we are not communicating. This one goes by his own, this one goes by his own, that one goes by his own. We are not communicating. That to show love to the one who is backsliding. But today, what we have seen in our life, in our midst, when one brother is backsliding, somebody say, no, we don't want to talk about him. Did you try? Oh, no, you know, the pastor is the one, or the deacon are the one. Did you try? Maybe you can convince him. Amen. So let's have those kind of, let's have a testimony. I did something to him. This brother was backsliding. Yes, I did something. I went to him. I've talked to him. I tried hard. I fasted. And then you can be a witness. You say, I've tried. But my hand is loose now. Amen? So let me conclude. Project the paragraph, the witness, 530405, paragraph 86. Let's have a good experience with God. Let's do what God wants us to do so that we can be a true witness. Okay, let's read this one and then we're going to pray. Now, when it come time, the test of the fire, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, our God is able to deliver us from the fiery furnace, but nevertheless, if he doesn't, we are not bowing down. We are going to die a real witness. So in you, anything happen, you are sure that it's God who talked to you. You have evidence that God has done something in your life. No matter what. Even though you are calling somebody's dying. You pray. God did not come to answer your prayer. Does not mean that God doesn't like you. Does not mean that God doesn't answer. God knows why. Amen. We cannot understand it now, but we understand it later. Amen. Let's continue. And then he say, I like that. I like that old courage. Like old Buddy Robinson. He said, Lord, give me the backbone like I saw log. That is the kind of witness to be. Courage. God likes us to be courageous. Amen. Any situation. We are witness. I've lost this. I was sick. They do this. They steal this. Yes, we are witness. But now what God is asking you, to be courageous. Amen. Amen. We want to have that courage. You, a true believer. You, the one I'm talking this morning. I want you to be courageous. Amen. Amen. Let's continue. He told Joshua, before he crossed over, said, be thou very courageous, for the Lord thy God is with thee. Whatsoever thou goest, you say, well, if God will tell me like he did Joshua, I will have some courage too. He has told every believer the same thing. Are you a believer? Amen. God has told you like he told Joshua. Be courageous. Everywhere you go, any situation, be courageous. That's the testimony you have. That people, they can say, yes, this is a witness. You've heard something, you make it to practice, and God come to seal it. Let's go. Leave thee. Don't forsake thee. Courageous. Let God take the promise. Then, God gave us the promise. Let be a real witness. Amen. Amen. Not a witness for people to see that you are a real one. No, a real witness. That God himself, he can say, I have my people over there that God told Satan. You do see my son? Because God was sure that he has a witness. And the prophet said that this time also God wants us to be his witness. The witness is not only the prophet. The witness is you and me. Because the prophet said the witness today is the Holy Ghost. That's right. Now the Holy Ghost in you make you a witness. Right. Amen. Amen. We need to testify about our God. We need to know, to understand things. This part is for the prophet. This one is for the believers. This one is not for no believers. But us, now the Holy Ghost is for the believer. Let's accept it. Let's act upon it. And then God will grant us what is behind the promise. Amen. Amen. Are you one of them?
Amen.
Not by mouth. Not by singing. But we want to see the life. Amen. We are preaching every time we came here. You listen to the tape every time. Time on the phone with your friends. It's just to prepare you to make sure that one of the day he is coming. Let be a true witness of this message. Everywhere we go, let be a true witness of this message. One of them. I'm so glad I can say I'm one of them. I'm one of them. One of them. I'm so glad I can say I'm one of them.
One of them. I'm one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. I'm one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Though these people may not learn to be, no boast of earthly fame, they have all received their Pentecost, baptized in Jesus' name, and are telling now both far and wide his power is yet the same. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. I'm one of them. Hallelujah, one of them. I'm so glad, I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Service came. Now what he did for them that day, he'll do for you the same. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Oh, one of, hallelujah, one of. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. I'm one of them. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Come, my brother, seek this blessing that will cleanse your heart from sin, that will start the joy bells ringing and will keep your soul aflame. It is burning now within my heart, oh glory. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them.
To God, you know your status, you know your position. Nobody can tell, but yourself, you can tell it better than anybody else. This time, can you commit yourself to God? Can you ask God, God, I want you to come like you promised in your word, that you'll be with us, you'll be in us. Ask God to be in you for you to bear fruit. Ask God to be in you so that you can testify about him. Ask God to be in you so you can be a true witness of what God has said. If God is not in you, if you are not born again, if you don't have the Holy Ghost, how can you talk about God? How can you testify about God? You need to be a true witness if you see, if you hear. It's only when God is in you, then you can know. But if not, this is the time for you to ask God, God, I want to be a true witness. I want to witness about your world. I want to witness about you. But I cannot do it by myself. I want you to come and then help me. If you are truly, truly born again, if you have the Holy Ghost, my brother, the temptation will be there. The trials will be there. But it will be good for you to make sure that those temptations will pass away. Let's have love. Ask God to give you more love. To love your enemy. To love your brothers. To love your sisters. Because over there is the love. It's not knowledge. It's love. We are at the end. The prophet said, everything shows that we are at the end time. What remains is the rapture. What are you going to say if you are not a witness? You can come to church every Sunday. You can come every Thursday. You can have more knowledgeable. You can read, you can understand. But what is the Holy Ghost in you? It's not a routine. Like I was reading the prophet, it's not a routine. Just coming to church and then going, coming to church and going. No, this is the time for you, yourself. Let God use you. Don't point finger to others. Like this brother have a gift. God can use you also to have that gift. God can use you. The prophet was praying, was saying that, God, use me. to let pressure go for my brother. Let God use you also for you to let the pressure go to somebody. So means that you have peace in you. Wherever you go, let that peace surrender the place. Let that peace be that place. This is the time you want to be a true witness of what God said, what you have heard, what you have seen. If you never accept Jesus Christ, accept Him so you'll be a witness. You cannot talk about God if you don't know, if you are no witness. If you don't, cannot talk about God if you don't have a clue, if you don't have agreement with Him. The prophet said, for you to have a good fellowship with God, you have to have an agreement with Him. You never agree with God. Why are you talking about God? First, there need to be an agreement. And then you can be a good witness. God bless you. I'll call Brother Fukumi to come. Give us a closing prayer. And the song leader will lead us in song.
Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you once again for how you have come down to speak to us this afternoon. Lord Jesus, you have come into the crevices of our heart where we need to be encouraged, where we need to be chastised. You've spoken to us. Lord Jesus, the main purpose why we are here on the surface of this earth is to be witnesses of your blessings. To be witnesses, O Father, Lord, of that Holy Spirit, O Lord, that came down on the day of Pentecost. Father, Lord, just anywhere we might be falling short, oh Lord, may you have mercy upon us in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, myself included, I've come before you, oh Father, Lord, every one of us, seeking each day as we go forth, oh Lord, to be true witnesses of this gospel, to go back to that day on Calvary and say, oh Lord, as from that time, something was different in my life. Oh Lord, help us, oh Lord, to remember the experiences you have given unto us. When you healed the sick, oh Lord, when you raised the dead, oh Father, Lord, when you changed our life, oh Father, Lord. Brother Abraham said one of the biggest miracles, said, we look for miracles, but it's the greatest miracle not that a sinner was made into a saint. Oh Father, Lord, we look into ourselves, oh Father, Lord, the desire, Lord, to serve you, to live for you, oh Father, Lord, to check ourselves against the word. Isn't that the true testimony of your grace in our lives? Oh Lord, that we were once sinners, oh Father, lusting after the things of the world, could one day turn around and say, oh God, I want to be more like you. Oh Lord, isn't that the miracle of your grace? Oh Father, Lord, may you help us every day as we go, oh Lord, to continue to be witnesses of this salvation in the name of Jesus. Help us, oh Lord, not to just speak with our lips, oh Father, Lord, but to live lives, oh Lord, that will be written in epistles read of all men in the name of Jesus. Oh God, as some of us are young in the spirit, some that are older, help each of us, oh Lord, to face temptations as they come and trust in your grace to overcome in the name of Jesus. Lord God, as many as are still seeking this baptism of the Holy Ghost, do not pass them by. Oh Lord, as some of us are witnesses of that grace, oh Lord, that spirit coming to dwell in a man, oh Lord, it is a remembrance, oh Lord, that it is possible for all of us to have it. Lord Jesus, may you put in these young ones, oh Father Lord, as many as do not have it, the thirst for that spirit of God in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, no man cometh to you except the Father draws him first. Lord, may you put that thirst in each and every one of us. Help us, oh Father Lord, as we go this afternoon, oh Lord, may your word never depart from us. May we continue to meditate on these things, oh Father Lord, to be better Christians each day than the day before. Have mercy on us, Lord. Let your name be glorified in our lives. Lord, the church as a whole, you commit into your hands. May your spirit never depart from us. We thank you, Father, for all these things. Your servant that you have used, certainly virtue has gone out of him. Oh Lord, may you replenish him in the name of Jesus. May you continue to bless his ministry. Oh Lord, may you continue to use him, oh Lord, to the furtherance of your kingdom. We appreciate you. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, I pray the faith and thanksgiving. Amen.
God bless you. Have a wonderful weekend. Happy Father's Day to the fathers.
Amen. Let's sing, Know Ye Not. Know Ye Not, ye are a temple of the Holy Ghost.
Noina, 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 ye are a temple. Noina, Noina, ye are a temple. Noina, Noina, ye are a temple. Ye are a temple of the Holy Ghost. Yes, I know, yes, I know, yes, I know I am a temple. Oh, yes, I know, yes, I know I am a temple. Yes, I know, yes, I know I am a temple. I am a temple of the Holy Ghost, full of praise. Full of praise, full of power, full of glory. Full of praise, full of power, full of glory. Full of praise, full of power, full of glory. I am a temple of the Holy. Oh, full of praise, full of praise, full of power, full of glory. Full of praise, full of power, full of glory. Full of praise, full of power, full of glory. I am a temple of the Holy Ghost.
Amen. As we come to the ending of our service, thank you for joining us this morning, this afternoon as well. As we disperse, let's sing Showers of Blessings, and we'll be back here on Thursday evening at 7. God richly bless you all. There shall be showers of blessings.
Showers of blessings we need. Mercy drop round us a falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessings. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of, oh, showers of blessings we need. Mercy, mercy drops round us a falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessings, precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain. Showers of God's showers of blessings we need. Mercy, showers we plead. There shall be showers of, oh, send them upon us, O Lord. Grant to us now a refresh. Come and now honor thy word. Shower, God showers of blessings. God bless you all. Mercy, mercy drops round us a falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing. Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing, now as on Jesus we call. showers of God's showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops round us, a falling.